Is that man jealous of you?
Yes. Yes, he is. Listen, if you heard me ask that question and you had to think about it, then yes. Then yes. I would like to spend this time going through all the signs that usually stand out the most to tell you whether a guy is jealous of you. Because you know what? Men don't have to be jealous of you just because someone else is attracted to you or because you're taller than them. It literally be the most smallest things, yeah? And when you are a woman who knows her power, who is bold, who is sexy, and who attracts all kinds of guys, you're going to come across men who are jealous of you, and there's nothing you can do about it other than to make yourself smaller, because that's what they want. Because when you make yourself smaller, you make yourself more accessible. And the root of that man's jealousy is his resentment towards you for not being within his reach so that he can sleep with you and derive some ego points. So one of the ways to know if a man is jealous of you, this is a very common one, and I'm surprised that a lot of women miss this, but it's when he withholds compliments from you, even though he can see that what you did is clearly amazing. Like, he will deliberately try and stand out by being the one person that either doesn't tell you that you look nice, or, I don't know, if you're a saxophone player, he won't tell you that you play the saxophone amazingly. Or if you're a footballer, he won't tell you that you did that, what do you call it, kippy-oppy. You did the kippy-oppy really well. Like, whatever it is that you do as a woman, yeah, that you're good at, that is worthy of praise and applause, he will usually be the one person that will, for some reason, not find that amazing. And I find that very shady. Even if you're not doing something that is skill-based and you're just beautiful and he happens to not be complimenting you, that's shady. It's shady because he's doing that thing that guys do where when they have nothing to offer you, when they don't have no money to impress you, when they don't have no achievements that match yours for them to not feel insecure in your presence, they go for the basic thing of treat them mean to keep them keen. But it's like, you're a man. You're a man. You're supposed to be pursuing a woman. That's literally the order of nature. Like I always say, we can do our feminism day in and day out and talk about all the ways that we should rebrand and update gender roles, and you know, we should question what it means to be a woman and what it means to be a man. And I completely agree with that. I am constantly questioning what it means to be a man and what it means to be a woman. But remember that if you as a woman are the only person that's doing the questioning of societal meanings, but the men you're engaging with are not questioning anything and they're just going off of the same conditioning that everybody else before them and around them are going off of, your questioning is just for yourself, because those men are still going to interact with the world in the way that they know how to interact with it. And most men are going to interact with the world in a patriarchal manner, and that includes women. They're going to interact with women in a patriarchal manner. And when men interact with women in a patriarchal manner, they're usually interacting with those women from the desire of trying to assert dominion over those women, because they don't know it any other way. And if that means them using psychological tactics to try and assert dominion over you, i.e. getting into your head by not complimenting you, they will do that. And usually the men who go for those like old school technique of don't give her no compliments so that she will suddenly see that you stand out and she'll want your compliments more, that only works on insecure women. So that tells you then that if a man behaves in that way where he don't give you no compliments, but you're a clearly beautiful woman, you're a clearly accomplished woman, you're an interesting and talented person, and you're getting nothing from that man who you know he likes you, you've picked up on that and you're confident in that, then that tells you that that man is used to dating insecure women and you're not in his league, you're beyond his league, because he needs to go and find insecure women who'll be responsive to that behaviour. Because remember, men are always going to do what they're used to getting away with. They're always going to behave in a way that they know has worked for them in the past. So it's never personal. It's never personal. And it always helps as a woman to keep that in mind when you're interacting with a man who is behaving in this manner that I'm describing. It's not personal, because if you take it personally, you're going to react in a way that's personal. You're going to give him more energy than he deserves. You're going to be upset that he's not complimenting you. You're going to act passive and funny with him. He's going to know that what he's doing is eliciting a reaction from you. And that tells him that you like him. But if you're not taking his lack of compliments personally, because you're getting compliments elsewhere, or because even if you're not getting compliments elsewhere, but you can see through what he's doing and you treat his behavior as neutral, he's going to be bothered by that, because he expects for you to feel a way. So it's like, it's never personal. Men are just doing what they're used to doing. And this leads on to my second pointer of identifying when a man is jealous of you. This one is a very common one, and this is such a modern age thing that maybe older people who don't use social media might not be as aware of, but it's when a guy is watching all of your stories but never says a word. Mr. Invigilator. Augusti CTV. Uncle Cyber Security. Always watching me but never saying a word. Wonder why that is. You keep coming back here to come and look at something, but you never say a word. You know, I can see you seeing me. I can see you watching me. I'm watching you watching me, sir. Why are you doing that? That's really weird, because, you know, I've noticed that when somebody, even if it's a guy or even a woman friend, or just a friend that happens to be a guy, or just a friend period, yeah, if that person who is fond of you, they don't have any attraction to you, but they're fond of you from a wholesome place. They maybe see you post a lovely picture of yourself, or they are a frequent watcher of your stories. Like most people who have friends watch each other's stories, but they're a frequent watcher of your stories, and they, you know, they have a very wholesome, healthy fondness for you. They will usually sometimes interact with you and engage with you. They might, you know, if you posted a cute picture of a dog or something that you walked past on your way somewhere, and you post that cute picture, they might comment something like, oh, that's cute, and they carry on with their day, because they don't see any sort of mind game they need to play with. Oh, is she going to think that I'm onto her if I just comment on this picture of a dog she posted on her story? Let me not comment on anything. Let me just watch from the bushes, you know? Or if someone has a healthy fondness for you that's just neutral and normal, if you happen to post a picture of yourself where you look nice, they won't feel weird about telling you that you look nice because you look nice. Do you know how many of my friends, guys and women, who I be smashing the like button in their stories, I'll be like, you look good, I hope you had a nice day, I love that cotton color on you, you go girl, what is that, you, yeah, what, you smashed it, you ate that, what, body bag, you killed it, hey. Like, I'll be giving people compliments if there's no reason for me to play a mind game, if there's no reason for me to like hoard my fondness for this person in order to play a game with them, it shouldn't feel weird to give them a compliment. So that's usually another giveaway. If a guy fancies you but doesn't have a genuine or healthy way to go about it, he's going to quietly watch you and never say a word. Girl, you could do a triple backflip with a fucking cartwheel, land on your feet upright, do a double pirouette, do a front flip, land on a clean split, roll over and smile, and he will not say a word, because he doesn't want you to know that he's impressed by you. Because for some reason, your awareness of him being impressed by you is going to give you some sort of power over him, because he's overthinking it. Like, I'm telling you, that's what it is. Because usually those same guys who are overthinking their interactions with you, the women that they don't fancy, or the people that they have no romantic interest towards, they are, you know, they're showing support to those people. They're telling those people that they look cool, or they like their shoe, or that they like the color of the yellow that they use in their painting, whatever it is. They have a neutral, healthy outlook towards offering compliments to people. But it's the silent watchers that you should be very wary of, especially if, and this leads to my next point, the silent watching is happening after they have started a conversation with you that maybe has a flirty foundation to it. So a lot of these guys, what they'll do is, like, they might flirt with you in the DM. Or if you know them in person, they might have flirted with you in person. Or however you've interacted with them, where they have given you a clear impression that there is some fancying of you going on from their side. With guys, right, I've noticed the ones that are really insecure, they'll be nice to you first. If they like you, they'll be nice to you to the capability that they can do. If that doesn't elicit the reaction that they wanted, whether that means you sleeping with them or you flirting back with them or you going back and forth in this like flirty game with them, if you don't give them the reaction that they wanted after they've been nice to you, they go quiet. So that's usually when they start to become the secret story lurkers. Who, it's not secret because you can see them watching your stories, especially if you've already interacted with them on Instagram DM. Once you've interacted with someone in the DMs a handful of times, they will show up amongst the first 10 names listed of your story watchers on Instagram because the app is of the assumption that you know this person. So it will be in your interest to know that they've been watching what you're doing. So in that same breath, it's like, if that guy was flirting with you on the DMs and maybe you entertained it for a little bit and for some reason you went quiet or he didn't get the response he wanted or he didn't get the outcome that he wanted, he's going to start secretly watching you and not giving you no nice compliments. He's just going to be looking at you, hoping that you will reach out to him because you haven't heard from him, because he wants to know if you care about him, because he's a fucking man baby who doesn't know how to be a man and just like take ownership of his feelings and be a man about it. He wants to use reverse psychology to see if that will get a reaction from you instead. Like, it's the whole idea of he's acting unbothered with you after literally flirting with you a week beforehand. Don't you think there's something strange about that? How can someone go from being interested in you and flirting with you to suddenly acting like they don't know who you are and not checking in on you and not talking to you? You didn't stop being attractive in that 7-day window. If anything, if you're like me, you became more attractive in that 7-day window. But nothing on your part changed in that 7-day window. It's all the changes happened on his part because he's now trying to see if, okay, maybe if I just like don't flirt with her anymore, is she going to reach out? She ain't gonna reach out, babe. So you're now the person that's watching from the bushes like a weirdo. And another thing that can make a guy jealous of you is if he knows that you're more accomplished than him. Oh, that's just perpetual blue balls for him. Because he can't impress you. And the things he knows he can use to impress you, he doesn't want to do it because This again goes back to what I was saying earlier about men are going to do what they're used to getting away with. Men are always going to behave in a way that they know has worked in the past. They're always going to go by what has been tried and tested. It is never personal. So if you're more accomplished than him, and if in the past he's come across accomplished women who he has ignored them into liking him back, he's going to ignore you into hopefully you liking him back. That's it. Like, he feels more of an ego boost from knowing that an accomplished woman is interested in him even when he has taken his foot off the gas. That's why I'm telling you, it tells you a lot about a man's outlook on life and how successful that man is likely to be based on how he treats you in the period where he's supposed to be pursuing you. Because if that man is reaching for reverse psychology tactics and that man is hoarding compliments and that man is disappearing on you after heavy-handedly flirting with you a week beforehand, he's giving me the vibes of the same kind of man who drives without his seatbelt on. Like, the two are interlinked, babe. He's giving me the vibes of a man who, like, he's gaslighty, like, usually there's more bad behavior where the stuff you're noticing has come from. It tells me he's not a man who knows how to make money and he's not a man who can take care of you, because if that man knew how to make money, he would know how to see things through properly Mm-hmm. And, you know, I personally don't like to date men who don't know how to make money, because money matters to me, safety matters to me, financial comfort matters to me. And if you're doing the hot and cold thing in the stage when I'm supposed to be becoming enticed to want to get to know you better, then what are you going to be like if I lower my self-worth enough to date you? You're going to be dreadful. You're probably going to make me split the bill with you. Not doing that. I think, yeah, when a man can't impress you, it does make him feel like less of a man. And that's his personal problem. Because, like I said, if you keep trying to do that feminism thing of trying to save men from the problem that they created and they continue to reinforce, you're doing yourself a disservice. And what I mean by trying to save men from the problem that they've created and constantly reinforce is when you try to redefine masculinity for men who are not trying to redefine masculinity for themselves. So that means if you're like a proper like feminist academic woman who, you know, holds the belief that men shouldn't be valued according to their ability to make money, and men shouldn't be valued according to how much they are physically built as a man, and men shouldn't be valued according to how hyper-masculine that they can make themselves, which I completely agree with all those three things. I agree that men are human beings and they are more than the money that they make. I agree that men are human beings and they deserve to have the same emotional depth and sensitivity that women have. I also agree that men should not have to be defined by how hyper-masculine they're able to be. That doesn't mean that men agree with you though. Like, men be embodying ideas that stunt their growth every single day and they don't seem to have a problem with it. So in the same breath, like, look, if you're an accomplished woman, that man probably sees you as competition because he has unhealthy views on masculinity that he has chosen to not interrogate. So even if you have evolved and healthy views on what a man should be, and you make, you know, leeway for men, that man ain't making no leeway for himself. He sees you as competition. Whether you like it or not, whether you even see him as competition or not, he sees you as competition, and that's why he's airing you. That's why he's trying to use reverse psychology to try and ignore you into trying to like him back. It's because he's choosing to cling onto malevolent definitions of masculinity, even to his own detriment, because all he has is his ego, and that tells you that he's dumb. Like, it tells you that he's not even someone to be fucking. Like, it don't matter if he can finger blast you really good. He's still an idiot. You gonna let an idiot finger blast you? Because it's like, look, when men be loitering around you online, yeah, you can tell that, like, they like you, but they're too insecure to do the thing that they're supposed to do because they're scared you're gonna reject them. Well, good. You should be scared that a woman who you've done nothing to impress will reject you, because she will reject you because you've done nothing to impress her. If you have a fear that she's going to reject you, you haven't done enough. And then you now let that fear win by doing even less to impress her, by ghosting her and watching what she's doing. Like she can't see you watching her. Don't you think that that makes you look like even more of a wet flannel, sir? And I'm not turned on by men who behave like wet flannels. I'm actually very, very turned off by men who play that hot and cold game. Because look, this ain't my first rodeo. I have come across men who have been headstrong and bold and confident and courageous in their pursuit of me. And that has gone way further than it has with a man who has tried to do the reverse psychology, throw stones and pebbles at your window and hide his hand to see if you'll come and check for him type of approach. Because look, the loitering thing, that body language shows that he is still interested in what you're doing and he is still interested in you. Because you know what, yeah, most men can't help their attraction to you. They can hide it, but they can't help it. And that's the fallacy of the man. Like, that's just the thing about men and their useless boners that they can't control. They be angry at their own selves for literally having a boner and still hating you. Like, with men, two things can be very true at once. A man can be attracted to you and also dislike you. Very possible. And when a man is attracted to you, and also dislikes you, that pushes him further into a mental place of wanting to exert dominion over you to get over his dislike for you, because it makes him want to conquer you to prove to himself that he's better than you. So now this has become a whole different game now. Like, it's a whole different conversation than what it could have initially been, where he was just flirting with you because he liked you and maybe you gave him a bit of attention because there was a point where you found him attractive too. And then somewhere down the line, you weren't reciprocating his low effort and then he became resentful, but he's still attracted to you throughout the beginning up until the point where he's now trying to dip in and out of ghosting you and trying to see what he can do to passively get your attention. He's been attracted to you from the beginning, but the way that he's trying to manage his attraction is to convince himself that you ain't all that anymore by him ignoring you while still watching you. Men are not that hard to figure out. And this is why a lot of them hate that I have this podcast. Because I can see through their game. And this is why I've been saying as of recent that now that I'm 28 years old, I'm way more open to dating much older men. I don't think there's anything that a man of my age can do for me other than favors and run errands for me, which is useful too. But am I going to like bind myself to a 28 year old man? Nope. Unless he's got money and unless he's down for an open relationship, because I ain't doing no mutual, monogamous, faithful relationship with a 28 year old man. Come on, he's 28. Like, you got to count 18 for him mentally. What I would do with a 28 year old man is spend his money and spend other guys' money. And he should enjoy having his money spent. He may or may not get to press breast, depending on what mood I'm in. But that's as far as it goes. I don't take 28-year-old men seriously. And I don't take men younger or even a little bit older than that seriously. Would I take a 50-year-old man seriously? No, but I would, you know, take him seriously enough to spend his money more longer term and maybe date him properly. Not marry, but maybe date him properly. I don't take men seriously. I take their money seriously because money is the one thing that shows you investment, and men go where they've invested. That's just the way life is. You can argue day in and out about how money should not be a marker of someone's intentions, and I agree with that, but that's just not how men behave. So you got to go according to what you're seeing, not what you're thinking, unfortunately. But you know, another thing is men don't want to come across as a fan if they are insecure. And this goes back to them not wanting to congratulate you, them not wanting to compliment you. If you're a well-accomplished or talented woman, he's not going to want to clap for you because he doesn't want to feel like a fan. Because remember that he doesn't have anything to derive a sense of achievement from, because maybe in his life, the thing that he is the goodest at, the thing that makes him feel really accomplished, isn't even something that you care about. So he just feels like a squished bug under your shoe. And for that reason, he thinks that he can stand out by not being a fan. When this is how you know men are just dumb people, because it's like, if you want to win a woman's favor, you got to be a fan, babe. Like, you either like women or you don't like women. So if you like women, you need to be a fan of women, because women are amazing and women deserve to have fans. If you don't like women, then step to the side, innit? And don't be a fan and just stand there, innit? Like, no one is checking for you, because the men that are trying to halfway it are the men who want to be chased. And those are the men they've got more feminine energy than masculine energy. And, you know, this quickly kind of pivots briefly into the conversation of dating bisexual men or dating queer men. I am very open to dating bisexual men. I'm very open to dating queer men. Where I take issue with bisexual men or queer men is when their femininity has seeped into the parts where I'm gonna need their masculinity to be masculine in. Meaning, look, if a man wants to be, you know, feminine in how he dresses and wants to be feminine in the way that he interacts with me sexually, if that includes, if that man wants to be submissive towards me sexually, which I would consider feminine in some aspects, even though it's masculine in other ways too, to want to serve a woman and give your money and power to a woman. As long as, listen, I'm happy to, and if he wants to, you know, be flamboyant and quirky in how he appears, listen, I'm all for that, as long as he's paying my bills, as long as he makes me feel taken care of, as long as he supports me, congratulates me, and nurtures my well-being. We are good. You can be as fruity as you want. I love me a fruit shoot. I love me some Frutella. I love me some round trees. Love me some Haribos. But it's about making sure that my key needs are being met. So it's not even about like whether a guy is feminine or it's just, is he jealous of you? Is that man jealous of you? Because sometimes, ironically, you'll find, yeah, that queer men actually have a bit more of a capacity to appreciate the nuances of a woman's sensuality just because they're more enthusiastic about similar things that women enjoy. But again, like I said, I don't mind dating a man who also dates men as long as his masculinity happens to show up in places where I appreciate the masculinity the most, i.e. bills being paid, money being given to me, him being of service to me. Everything else is just an extra added colour to the rainbow that is his queerness and our joint mutual fluidity together. I'm all for that. Hashtag LGBT. But yeah. If this man is aware that other men treat you well and he can see it in how you carry yourself, and maybe he can even see, whether it's in your comments, he can just see other men like simping wholesomely for you as they should be, because men should be simping over women. Like I said, you're either a fan of women or you're not. If he can see all that happening, he's gonna wanna stand out by being cold to you. And it's like, yeah, you stand out as a weirdo. You're not going to stand out as someone that I'm going to suddenly date or someone I'm going to suddenly start chasing. Yeah, you've made yourself known to be a weirdo and you have now reduced your chances of me giving you attention when, not if, because the when is inevitable, when you lose steam, you lose momentum, you become bored, you become desperate, you become lonely and you want my attention again and you go back to ground zero and square one of suddenly giving me attention and compliments and trying to talk to me and suddenly liking all my stories and suddenly being proactive and telling me how much I'm amazing because you've realised that the ignoring didn't work, but you just look like a weirdo. Because men who are healthy, men who are good for you, men who want well for you, men who actually want to support you, men who actually like women, don't play with those weird mind games. They just act like they like you because there's no shame in you knowing that that guy likes you. It's not hard. And the guys who make it hard only make it harder for themselves. And I know that deep down those guys are not satisfied, because if that's the way a guy acts in the presence of a woman that he fancies who is beyond his reach because he's not doing enough, then that tells me that he only dates women who have low self-esteem. That's not a flex. A woman has to significantly hate herself to date you. How's that feel? That ain't nice, is it? Mm-mm. Do you know what is a flex? A woman loving herself so much that she only dates men like you. That's the real flex. But you can't even attain such a flex because you're too busy playing mind games with women who are not checking for you because you went and spoiled it for yourself. Because you know what, yeah? A lot of these guys who are playing mind games with you, they play those mind games because at some point you did give them attention back. At some point you were almost interested and they did something to piss you off. And they know that what they did to piss you off can be rectified, but what it will take to rectify it usually means that they're going to have to maintain that rectified behavior moving forward. And if they can't afford that, they're going to not want to do that. So that usually means, like, if that man knows that you like men who spend money on you, you like men who do things for you whether you ask them to or not, you like men who just want to enhance your life and make it easier. If he knows that that's the kind of man you like, yeah, he might try and be that for the first few weeks of you knowing him to see if that's going to keep you around. And then when he notices that you start liking it, instead of for him to continue, he stops because he can't afford to maintain that. Or maybe he can afford to maintain it, but he wants to see if he can still get you for cheaper. Because you know what? There are some women who, unfortunately, like, they they be letting men just treat them anyhow. And sometimes these men started out being very grandiose towards them. You know, some of these men started out buying them gifts and taking them nice places, treating them to incredible experiences. And then both the man and the woman just kind of like lost momentum. So the woman stopped desiring that treatment from the man. And the man, lucky for him, from seeing the woman has stopped desiring that treatment, the man has stopped giving that treatment. So now you're with a man who did a lot to get you, but isn't doing half as much as he did to get you to keep you. So now you've kind of just plateaued so early on. And this guy now knows that all he had to do was kind of buy your attention. Because this is the part where I agree when women who are uneducated about dating men with money say annoying things like, oh, I don't want a man to buy me. I don't want a man to buy my attention. He's only buying your attention if that's what it takes to get your attention, but it's not what it takes to keep your attention. Meaning that if it's the other way around where the man knows that for a woman like you to be in his life, there's a standard of behavior he must uphold, then of course he will do that same thing to get your attention. You know, the gifts, the money, the incredible experiences, but that will remain a consistent theme throughout the relationship. So he's not buying your attention. He's just meeting your standard because he happens to be able to. Where I believe he's buying your attention is if he does it to get your attention and then after that, he just goes back to treating you like a mediocre person. You can't let guys do that to you. Like, you literally have the final say. You have the thing that he wants, which is your pussy. So if he wants your pussy, he has to work for it and you get to make the rules. You're not harming men by having rules. Like, people be just holding on to ideas that don't even serve them, but it instead serves the people that are oppressing you. Like, the belief that, oh, men are harmed when women have standards that are too harmed. How? How are men harmed by women having high standards? Because when women have standards that are too high for men, those men end up becoming jealous of those women. And some of those men go on to harm those women as a result of acting on their jealousy towards that woman. So actually, it's women that end up still being harmed by having, whether we have high standards or low standards, we're at risk of experiencing harm at the hands of men. Because if that man likes you and has developed an unhealthy fixation towards you and your standards are too high for him, if he's bad vibes, he's going to inflict harm on you based on his resentment. In the same way, if you have low/no standards and that man is aware of that and he knows he can get away with a lot of shit, if that man is bad vibes, he's going to inflict harm on you because he knows that he can. So whether you have high standards or not, that's neither here nor there, because you're still going to be susceptible to oppression at the hands of men. So if you're going to still be susceptible to oppression at the hands of men, you might as well just have high standards, because it somewhat kind of decreases your chances of experiencing oppression at the hands of men. And then at best, you get great treatment at the hands of men. So it's like, look, there's no need to be dating men who make it a challenge to date them, because they want to be chased and they're exerting the wrong kind of feminine energy. Men who want to be feminine and want to be chased by women should go and explore their queerness and go and date men, because that's some queer behavior. That's some fruity shit. And like I said, we love some Haribo and Frutella around here, but go and do that over there with the men who are happy to chase men. You can't be expecting the women that you want to be in your life to chase you. That's just not how it works. It's not going to work, and it's never going to be that way. And men are never going to accept that. And that's okay, but it's your responsibility as a woman to be discerning enough to know when a man is having you on by trying to play reverse psychology mind games with you, and understanding that you winning that game is an arbitrary win that does nothing for you if that win don't come with some money. Because I don't care what anyone says, you know, there's always going to be this back and forth about, like, whether money taints a relationship or not, but it's like money is investment and a man should be invested in you because you're worthy of that investment. And a man will be the most devoted to the woman that he's most invested in. And that investment that bears the most value in his life is the financial investment. A man being financially invested in you doesn't mean that he isn't also emotionally invested in you. It just means that he's gone further beyond what is expected of the hypothetical, general, mediocre, basic man in our society. So I say all this to say, if that man is jealous of you, just keep on applying the pressure by acting like he don't exist, because he doesn't deserve to be acknowledged. And you continue to be finer and finer and more talented and less invested in even noticing whether he's watching you, because you will get to a stage where you don't even notice if he's watching your stories or not. You don't even remember to check if he commented or if he saw. You're just living your life because you've got attention from other people who actually have a healthy, wholesome attraction to you, or a wholesome, genuine fondness for you. And you don't have to be clamoring for the attention of that man who's trying to play reverse psychology mind games, because once you enter that headspace, he's won. So the way to win is to let him play that game with himself, and you just continue to be the wavy, incredible woman that you are, because he wouldn't be playing that mind game with you if you weren't incredible.